Hello and welcome to the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, episode 243, The Classics, Older Games That Should Not Be Forgotten. Brought to you by our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, and our fantastic Patreon patrons.
So tonight we've got a question about our favorite classic games. We follow that up with a short talk about the games we've been playing, which isn't much, and wrap up with a trio of reviews, two of which actually kind of fit the theme. First off, we've got Dragon Dice, a classic TSR game that's still going strong thanks to a new publisher. Then we have Targi from KOSMOS, which goes back to 2012. Then we break the chain by talking about KAPOW from Wize Wizard Games. At least the original version of KAPOW is 5 years old, so it slightly fits. Not really.
Well, before we get to all that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have Deanna.
Hi there to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
Show up Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode243. That's 243. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing at all to use, but support the show.
Note, some but not all games we mention tonight will be review copies provided by designers or publishers.
The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from local game designer Roger Malosh, who writes, "Hey Mo, thank you for doing such a great job answering my question about the burden of reading the rules. I was playing Concordia the other day and realized again what a great game it is. It's simple, elegant, and has enough depth to keep anybody happy. The same can be said about Acquire and other games that might be considered gaming classics. It's a shame that these games seem to fade into the background as the new hotness grabs everyone's attention. It would be cool if you had a short segment on your show where you mention one of these classic games. Maybe you can call it Looking Back or Meeple Memories or Classics Corner. I would love to hear what you and Sean and Dee now consider classic board games. These games shouldn't be forgotten."
Well, thank you very much, Roger, for the great question and the show suggestion. Wow, that came out weird. Show suggestion. It's like a she sells seashells on the seashore kind of thing there. Honestly, we've talked about this. We've talked about it multiple times. It's come up before. We've had multiple people in our chat room suggest some kind of segment. Especially every time we're like, we're not about the new hotness. Or like, well, then you should highlight some older stuff as well. And we've talked about it and waffled on it. And the whole problem is, and honestly, like maybe if we do another poll this year, we can see where people fall. Do people want the show to get longer? That's the whole problem. Right now, we try aim for 2 hours. Sometimes we're a bit over, sometimes we're a little under. But in general, our shows are 2 hours long. That's a pretty long for a podcast. Now, I know there's longer shows out there and there's a lot of shorter ones out there, but if we took a segment, even say once a month, once a week, whatever, I think we could probably do it every episode. There's probably enough games to talk about. But if we did throw a new segment in the show, either it comes at the expense of something else, which I would say, fine, we'll do two reviews and one of them will be classic. The problem with that is we need to get through the current pile of obligation. Our current pile of obligation is still significant. We're still trying to get games in from Origins last year in before we get to this year. And we'd have to lose something.
The pile of obligation is I think the biggest thing standing in the way of us actually doing that. I don't know. We've talked about this before. I want to acquire, play, and talk about all the weird, quirky old games. Like when we were in an antique store up at Mo's uncle's place and we found a game called Warp Out, which the box promised us was about both the Bermuda Triangle and Atlantis. A family game of suspense and chance from 1985. I brought it downstairs so I could show you all the awesome monster. How can you not want to play that? It was $5. We had to buy it. And I thought it would be a hoot to play this and talk about it on the show, but it's still sitting in the pile of shame. Or like one of our fans sent Mo a copy of The Generals, and I want to play that and talk about that. But I doubt that's what Roger meant by classics. But if you're talking new potential show segments, that is the one I want to do.
You see, I'd actually be really interested in Goodwilling and thrift shopping and, you know, finding the junk, finding those leftover forgotten gems, not classics. In fact, they're probably for the most part horrible games, but interesting from a historical standpoint, especially looking back in comparison to what we think of as hobby board games, or even more, even modern mass market games, which are so different from games of the 70s, 60s, and earlier.
Right, or like that round Connect Four-like game that Mo and I played a few weeks back at the brewery. I want to find all the quirky stuff like that, bring it home, play it, and talk about it, because I think that'd be neat.
See,
I said, I don't think that's Roger's question.
Well, my thing is, I think we'd want to mix it up. I think we would want to do, I honestly think it's worth talking about, you know, games that are 20, 30, 40 years old that are still good, as well as those weird retro. If we had a segment, I'd like once a month we do a 13th. We used to do a segment whenever we talked about really old games. We called it the 13th floor. Like you're in our hotel and you get off on the wrong floor. You get off on the 13th floor. And we always say, welcome to the 13th floor. You know, it's 1962 and you're coming around the corner and you see this game. And it's something we did a long time ago. I would love to bring back. And like some of those could be quirky games. And other times it'd be like you get off the 13th floor and it's 2000. And here's the hot game of 2000. But again, the whole problem is, we can do this, but the show get longer. I personally don't have a problem with the show getting longer, but Sean's the one that thinks it's too long as it is. And I think D's kind of in the middle. So I don't know what people are willing to put up with, I guess is the right word. If we become a 3-hour, 4 or 5 hour show like The Secret Cabal, they've got lots of fans. So there's definitely a market out there for it. And they can have all kinds of different segments and different shows, and we can change it. So one week we have these 4 segments, and the next time we have these 5, and the next one we only have 3.
I know Sean's talked about breaking it into like separate streams, for lack of a better word. And I don't want to do that. I just want to send out one podcast a week. But
so I don't know. I guess we'll just keep talking about it. Like if you want the segment bad enough, like I said, the problem is if we want to stick to our 2-hour time limit, we'd have to get rid of something else. We'd have to, I don't know, shorten the Ask the Bellhop. We switch our game recommendation episodes like tonight instead of discussing ahead of time what is a good train game or what is a train game or what is a classic game. We just go, here's our top X, 15, here's 5 each.
No, right? The debate's the fun part.
Yeah, I think a lot of what people I think like out of this is the discussion and, you know, game recs are a dime a dozen. Everyone has done game recs. IGN just bought Dicebreaker and, you know, more game recs coming there and all that.
I don't know. So right now, I don't think we're going to bring the 13th floor back right away, but it is something we will consider doing. So what I want to do tonight to at least, you know, help Roger out, instead of a new segment, how about a show? So that's what we're here tonight to do. We are going to do a show on our favorite classic games and games that shouldn't be forgotten, games that may be being overshadowed by the new hotness. But first, we got to talk a bit about what a classic game is, because independently, all of us kind of came up with a list of 5 games each, and we are all on very different pages.
So interestingly, I think somebody in the chat room today has already said something that I think I failed to express when we were discussing and writing some of this stuff earlier. Because to me, classic is a pretty unspecified term. A piece of literature might need to be 100 years old. A car might need to be 50. A video game might be 10 years old and considered a classic. Board games have been around for, I mean, literally millennia in some cases, if you go back to the, you know, games of Ur. But for generally speaking, you know, a few hundred years for games like chess and Go and checkers and modern things. We spoke recently about Stratego, which is just over 100 years old in its original form and has been more or less the same ever since. When it comes to more modern games, I think most people generally are willing to accept, you know, Catan. It's a classic game. None of us, I don't think, really argue about that. But what the Tabletop Express mentioned in the chat room is the difference between classic and modern classic. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where we've kind of separated, because I'm on the classic. He may even mention Stratego before we got to it. And that's where my brain goes when someone says classic to me. Whereas both of you, I think, are leaning more towards what they were considering modern classic.
Yeah, I feel pretty strongly that there are games newer than Catan that I would dub classics.
Yeah, reading Roger's question, I immediately thought modern classic. I didn't think of that term, but not even that. I just think classic hobby board game. Yes, board games have been around forever. hobby board games are still pretty new, and Catan can kind of be pointed out as the start of it, right? The Euro game, the German game invasion, the whole hobby board game thing is still a new industry and a new set of games and a new genre. So what I think of when you ask me this, or when I read Roger's question, is modern hobby board games. So games that you're not just, you can get at any toy store that exists. Not that there's a lot of toy stores left in the world, but you walk into a toy store or a department store and there's the same games that have been there for 100 years. To me, that's where my brain went originally. Like when you start talking about like chess and old ones, I'm thinking antiques, right? Like as far as, I don't know, like the term classic isn't perfect, right?
Not at all.
I don't know. I don't think 50-year-old games everyone knows and loves and knows. Everyone knows Scrabble. Everyone knows Stratego. Everyone knows those. To me, that doesn't fit the intent of the question, right? Roger calls out Concordia, which is definitely fairly modern and can easily and probably has been overshadowed by new hotness. Now, I don't know. No one's forgetting about chess or Battleship because there's a new mini game on Kickstarter.
So Roger mentions Concordia, and that's from 2013. So maybe a reasonable definition would be anything more than 10 years old. Like, I think maybe what makes a game classic is if it was popular when it came out, and not just like 3 weeks of hotness, something that's less fleeting. Something less fleeting. Bonus points if it has an effect on the industry as a whole, like introducing a new mechanic or using something in a novel way and then making that a trend. Like the problem here is the current nature of the board game industry. There's what, 5,000 games coming out a year or whatever the number is now? Yeah. So there's this, you know, the constant push towards the newest, best, hottest new thing, right? And games are quickly replaced and they're pushed out of the spotlight. So yeah, I think a game that's 10 years old, heck, I think maybe even 5 years old could be a classic board game. I think there are definitely games out there getting forgotten that deserve a second look.
Yeah, and I think, again, he did mention Concordia, which is newer.
Yeah.
A modern classic, perhaps, whereas he also mentioned Acquire, which is 50 years old and falls under my definition of classic, because Acquire is absolutely, I think, a classic game. It's got right. staying power. There's a brand new edition of it that just came out last year. So it's interesting. One of the things I was noticing when I was poking around and getting other people's ideas of classic and doing, you know, some of the research that we do for this show, I noticed that the classic book of board games was written by Sid Saxon and first published
designer of Acquire.
First published in 1991 and is still to this day published unchanged, aside from, you know, whatever editing and new covers they put on it. So the standard text defining the classic board games hasn't changed since hobby board games existed. Since hobby board games came into existence, essentially. Aside from, you know, the rare one like Acquire, which I think technically is a hobby board game, but not the modern definition, you know, post Catan that we know of. One of the things that I think of, and one of the things that's interesting to me is the whole idea of, you know, oh, everyone remembers Scrabble, so it can't be a classic, except everyone remembers Hamlet.
But I never said it can't be a classic. No, I just said it's not going to be soon forgotten, which was part of the question.
No, but I'm not questioning that the games are classic. It's pushed to the back. Is he doesn't actually say forgotten. He says, you know, pushed into the back. And to me, you know, you look at something like Hamlet, which I think most people will agree is a classic work of fiction, but nobody reads Hamlet anymore unless you're made to in the school for the most part. It's there. Most people have a copy of it on their bookshelf, but they don't read it. And the same to me could be said about games like Stratego. Yeah, everyone's got knows it. Most people have a copy of it. But do you ever actually play it and think about it?
And that's where I took Roger right here. Just to quote Roger, these games shouldn't be forgotten.
Someone wrote a definition in 1991 on what classic games are. You don't think that ever deserves to get updated? Come on.
Well, and to be fair,
that's like saying we're taking our classics literature list from 25 years ago and that's it. We're locked in.
I'm not saying it doesn't need to change. I'm just saying that the industry hasn't chosen to update the book. Like no one is actually making these changes. And yes,
no, I'm pretty sure Jeff Engelstein put out a book a couple years ago. Oh, Jeff Engelstein put out a book on modern games. Like it's I don't know, referencing an old 91 book before really the hobby game industry started. It's odd that book's still in print. That's all I can think of.
Someone must be using it in a classroom or something. Like it's
as I said, I'm wondering who's thinking that's still relevant.
Different target market. Well, that's
the thing. And part of me is a little frustrated by the fact of us being kind of niche and elitist. I don't mean that in a negative way, but Scrabble is as much a board game as Catan or Wallenstein
is. I totally agree with that.
Definitely.
Like I said, argument is no one's going to forget about it. For Roger's question, it's these games are getting overshadowed. They're not overshadowed. I can go buy one at the corner store.
Yes,
everyone knows about it. Everyone knows
about it. Like I said, everyone has a copy, but people aren't playing them. People are, especially the hobby gamers, are forgetting about them because, yeah, it's there in the back. Yeah, I know about Scrabble. When was the last time you played Scrabble?
Obviously, we cannot agree on what makes a gaming classic here.
At least Sean's admitted there are modern classics.
So yeah, no, absolutely. I think the definition of classic and modern classic is a very valid and an important decision that I think I probably should have come to and maybe we should have discussed earlier on. I wish Tabletop Express had been in on the discussion earlier today.
Fair enough. Yeah, no, to me, a classic is a game that had, 10 years, 5 years ago, a game you don't hear about anymore. Right. Like there, no one's hyping it. No one's talking about it. There's no buzz. Maybe you can play it on like Board Game Arena, but like there's no active threads on Board Game Geek about it. There's no podcasters talking about it, however many years that takes. But that it's still a solid game that people enjoy, that if you bring it out to game night, people are still excited to play it. Or when you sit down and play it, you go, man, that game is good. Why don't we play it more often? It's more the feeling of the game. Now, Deanna brought up the whole doing something new, and I think that's part of it, too. I think some classics deserve to be considered modern classics, whatever. I'm just going to say classics. Deserve to be on a list like this because they did something new, right? Like, it's hard to overlook games like Dominion, the first game. It wasn't the first deck builder, but the game that set up deck building as a genre. Or whatever. We're going to call it other games, so I don't want to call it everyone's games before we get to them. But, like, whatever. The first worker placement game, generally considered to be Kalis. Right. That is one that I almost put on the list tonight, but I wanted, for brevity's sake, I didn't list every game I thought should be a classic or a modern classic. I think those are the ones. It's those games that to me stand the test of time. That like El Grande is an old game as far as hobby board games are concerned. It's got an old look and it's got kind of dated mechanics. But then you sit down and play it and go, but this still works. It's still enjoyable. You could still hook new gamers with this. All right. Well, obviously, we weren't quite on the same page when we sat down, and we don't do these lists on the fly while we're live. Some of us prefer to do some research and some prep, and Deanna hates getting put on the spot. So we do prepare these ahead of time. So I will note that our list may have changed if we had had this discussion first, but we went with our original in-the-head definitions of classics. So, but what I want to know before we get to our list, though, we don't usually do this like in the middle of a segment, but I want to know from you listeners and viewers right now, what do you think constitutes a classic? We want to know your thoughts.
My list would not change. I live and die by it. No, seriously. We want to hear what you guys think about this. Post a comment wherever you are listening or watching. Send an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com. Hit us up on social media. Or let us know on Discord, which is you can find us at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
And feel free to direct your flames towards me at sean@tabletopbellhop.com.
Well, I don't think anyone's disagreeing with you. I just don't think it fits the criteria of the question we were asked. That's where we fall apart. We should have got that modern classic word out there sooner.
Well, with that, let's move on to some games we think shouldn't be forgotten. One thing we've gotten better about over the years is trying to make sure the games we recommend on the show are in print and easily available. Well, that's not always the case tonight. While yes, some of these games are, there are others which may be much harder to find.
So I'm going to start where Roger started. He already gave us a good one with Concordia from 2013. I am 100% on board with this recommendation. Like Roger, this is a game that whenever I break it out, I'm shocked by how good it is. And honestly, I guess I'm not anymore now that I'm admitting it. But like every time I play it, I'm like, I knew it was good, but I forgot it was this good. This is one of those games where we kind of dust it off. We play it and I'm like, oh my God. And then we invite Tori and Kat over and we play it. And I'm like, Sean, you got to come over. And then we play it with the kids and we play like a good 3-4, maybe even 5 times over like the period of a month. And then something new comes out, right? And we put it on the shelf and we're playing whatever, Games of Obligation or whatever. And it sits on the shelf until I'm like, someone brings it up, like Roger. And I'm like, Shan, I don't think Sean's tried Concordia yet. And we break it out and we play it 3 to 5 times. And honestly, I am currently thinking of putting Concordia as one of our heavy games on our menu for tomorrow night because of this whole topic. Now, this one is still in print, but the latest edition is actually called Concordia Venus. This was Rio Grande's way to bring the game back to the market and put out an expansion at the same time. So what you can do is you can buy Concordia Venus, and it's just an expansion for those of you like me who already have Concordia. But they also sell a version that has the complete game as well. So if you are new, if you're just hearing about Concordia for the first time tonight, because people have forgotten about it, pick up the Concordia Venus version that includes the full game.
Okay. When I think about classics, the first thing that pops into my mind is the games I played as a kid and still think of fondly today, like Dark Tower, which came out in 1981, and Stop Thief, which is from 1979. And both of these were republished by Restoration Games, so I'm thinking that someone else there felt like they were classics too.
Totally fair. I think Dark Tower is especially a great one. Well, Stop Thief, I don't actually remember, but Dark Tower absolutely fits both of our definitions, I think.
I still have my copy of Stop Thief. I'll make you play it someday, Sean.
Yeah, my problem is I didn't think the original Dark Tower was that good. That's why it doesn't belong on my list. And no, we haven't played the new Restoration Games version, but the new Restoration Games version is so different from the original. I don't even can call them the same game, right? It's switched to cooperative. It's got a tower and it's dark looking, but like you're not moving around the board. You're not going to the markets. You're not getting attacked by brigands. It's almost a completely different game. So I'm not sure on Dark Tower myself. Like, yes, having nostalgia for Dark Tower is fine, but I don't know. Like, I guess it was probably the first game with an app. It belongs for that reason.
The negatives of Dark Tower are it goes for an obscene amount on eBay.
Well, yeah.
And it can break down and you got to find just the right light bulb to put in it to make it work. But if you can get past that, I would still sit and play that game today.
All right. For me, again, we're jumping off onto a different tangent. I'm going to say Clue. Now, I know roll and moves are considered evil by many a gamer, but this classic game has not only lasted on its own merits for 75 years, but has inspired countless variants which can address the concerns of many, though to be fair, there are just as many garbage rethemes that can be completely discounted. The current top-ranked version, which is still available and is itself 30 years old, is Clue Master Detective. Interestingly, the ratings of this game, the different versions, tend to go down as modern versions are released compared to the original classic and Clue Master Detective, suggesting that it really is hard to beat the classic.
Now, in that case, how old is Clue Master Detective? Because Clue Master Detective is a different game. It's a more complicated version of Clue.
It's more of a gamer's game. Yeah, I wouldn't say it's a more complete version. So it basically took all of the different versions and put them into one. So there's more rooms and more people, but it's still the same essential game of guessing and moving around and finding the clues and guessing. They bulked it up with all the different bits from the Cluedo versions in Europe and other things. But yeah, it was 1988 was its release date.
Okay, so that's still pretty old. I wasn't sure. I just know that when talking about Clue, there'll be some gamer come out of the woodwork to say, make sure you play Master Detective, it's better. That's my experience with it. I have not played.
No, I haven't either, but I did do research into it because there's a bunch of different versions. Like, for instance, my family got the Harry Potter version of Clue, which was utterly broken. It literally fell apart because there was player elimination before you could guess. Although there is a different version of Harry Potter Clue, which is highly rated. And I don't know how you can tell them apart. I just know ours was not the good one.
Fair enough. I'll admit, Clue is one of the ones I think Deanna got me to sit down and play, and I was like, man, this is better than I remember.
Yeah, it's a game. It's an actual game, unlike some of the things I played as a kid.
Now, one of the oldest games I have in my collection that I still love, sadly doesn't get played enough, is El Grande. This one's 1995. This is the game to me that's almost more important than Catan. Like, this just predates. It's right on the cusp of the wave. The only difference was Catan got popular, right? Everyone bought it. It got the hype. I think El Grande is a better game. This is, in my opinion, the best area majority game ever made. Now, again, area majority, you're not fighting over spots. You're going for your bigger, whoever has the most cubes in an area, right? So more than one person's allowed to be in there. I absolutely adore this game. It's also did a bunch of innovations that now are pretty commonplace, but I don't think you've seen before that. So one of them is everyone starts with that same hand of cards, and those cards are your actions, and they determine your play order as well as your actions. So like if you play the 10, you're going to get tons of actions, but you're going to go last. And then once you use the 10, it's gone for the rest of the game. You see that still in modern games. And then there's the system for people, cubes being hidden in the tower. You have to have a memory element there and everything. Like, honestly, anytime I think about classic games on my shelf that need to be played again, El Grande comes to mind. And this one, like many of the games on the list, actually is easy to get again. It was just reprinted by Hans and Gluck, the original publisher, in 2023. And they were taking it seriously because they produced over 10 different regional language-specific versions. So they were trying to bring El Grande back in a big way.
Okay, yeah, I'm not going to argue El Grande is a good game, but the honest to God truth is I had completely forgotten it even existed. I had wiped it from my mind. I read it in your list and went, oh, yeah, El Grande. So, yeah, hidden classic, hidden on my shelf, right, you know.
Again, I haven't played this one, so I couldn't say.
Okay, I think everyone can agree that Catan is a classic, right? So, but there's a lot. I felt like, to answer Roger's question, like there was a lot of low-hanging fruit here. Like I could give the easy answers, right? Like Carcassonne, which came out in 2000, Agricola, 2007, Dominion, 2008, or how about Puerto Rico, which was 2002? And that is a game that I haven't heard anyone talk about in a long while. We played the heck out of Puerto Rico when we first got it. I think for a lot of people, Puerto Rico was the first introduction to the action selection mechanic where everyone gets something, but the person who chooses it gets a bonus. So it's a classic.
Oh, I agree. That Puerto Rico, I do appreciate that they put out a new edition, though they messed it up. There were some production issues, which as far as I know have been fixed. You might want to confirm that before picking up the latest edition, but they did fix some of the problematic theming in the original game. What I would recommend over that one still, though, is Race for the Galaxy, which is, to me, the next step from that Puerto Rico mechanic, or technically San Juan, which was the card version of Puerto Rico. But Race for the Galaxy is one of the few board games I have played over 100 times.
See, I love Race for the Galaxy, but I also like Puerto Rico. Both are good.
It's interesting because we talk a lot about Race for the Galaxy, and not as much as we used to, but all the time, except every once in a while it creeps in. Then you mention that it's too complex now. There's too many icons. There's too many things. So Race for the Galaxy has descended a bit from your where you once held it.
No, that's definitely true. It has. It's moved down a lot. Honestly, some new hotness kind of replaced it with Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition. So if I want that feel, that's probably what I'm going to go for now.
All right. Well, I went back in time again with Scrabble, another 75-year-old classic that I think is pretty hard to argue with as one that has settled into the collective consciousness as the word game. Whether it's being played on a board or on an app that someone has chosen not to license the name of, if you enjoy word games and spelling, you probably love Scrabble. Even if you choose to ban some of the two-letter words and other cheaty things and, don't refuse to acknowledge some of the modern words as legitimate and things. And again, this game has a bunch of variations on the original. The original still sells 1.5 million copies a year. But just this year, a month ago, I believe, they came out with a brand new cooperative version where one side of the board is the Scrabble we all know and love, and the other side is a modern cooperative version.
I'm not sure how I feel about cooperative Scrabble. No, I really... I'm on the fence about that. I guess I'd have to try it.
Yeah, I'm all for trying that. New Scrabble's good. My dad was one of those Scrabble people who memorized the dictionary, and I think because of that, I no longer had fun playing it. Eventually, we got him a Game Boy Color and a copy of Scrabble and let him play by himself. My next one was, for years, my number one board game, and I would force people to play it on my birthday, and that is Power Grid. Now, this is one that really you don't hear about anymore. This one does seem to have gotten lost in the new hotness over the last few years, but I would happily sit down and play a game, and I'm sure the same thing would happen when I used to force people to play it on my birthday, and that would be players sitting down expecting a math-heavy Excel spreadsheet. It's math the game and all the bad connotations and rumors put out there about Power Grid. We're going to sit down and they're going to play it with its rope-building game and iconic auction system and finish and go, wow, that was actually fun. I think of all the board games that, you know, the board game apologists, they're like, don't trust me, it's fun. This is the one where the most players after the game are like, man, that's really good. And they're like, man, that wasn't as hard as I thought. That wasn't like, people are intimidated by this game. And every time we bring it out, people are like, okay, when can we play again? When can we try the German map? Excuse me. When can we flip the board over and try that side too?
I will admit FireGrid still is out there. I mean, they're still putting out content for it. Not recently, but I mean, 2012, there was new expansions and content for it. So
it's definitely a classic. And I do feel like it's just faded, right? Because I can't remember the last time I heard someone mention FireGrid. So yeah, it's a good one. I went with Bonanza from 1997. And they recently put out Bonanza Dahlias with Beth Sobel art and a retheme that changed it from beans to flowers. And I haven't played the new version, but the blurb for the game says it features the same gameplay as original. So I think it's just a visual change. Regardless, I think it's awesome to see this game being revived. It is one of my favorites. And we have, I mean, wow, we've probably played it, you know, 500 times. I don't even know, like a lot. We've played it a lot.
It's interesting because Bonanza is one of the games that hasn't been forgotten in my mind, because even outside of our sort of collection of fans and hobby gamers, I hear people mention Bonanza. Like it's the game that I am not surprised to hear a non-hobby gamer mention when it comes to, you know, hobby board games.
I thought it was this weird, quirky game that we found in the 90s that no one else ever even knew what the heck it was. And when I saw it being re-released and rethemed, I was super excited. I was like, oh, more people are going to play Bean. Awesome.
My only disappointment is I can't go Bean if we're playing flowers.
Flowers.
Petals. Petals. It just doesn't. Seeds. I don't know. It doesn't have the impact. No, but Anza, I think this is a fantastic choice. It's the game that should have made Uwe Rosenberg famous, but Agricola was the one that actually ended up doing that many years later. He doesn't get enough credit for doing farming games before farming games were cool.
Fair. So I went a little newer this time. I went with a 50-year-old game of Rummy Cub. This one's been around a while and, of course, emerged as a variation of the card game Rummy. And interestingly, I just learned when I was researching that it existed because the communists banned playing cards. And so they wanted to play Rummy and they made Rummy Cub as a non-card version of Rummy under the communists. Now, there have been different versions and rule sets for the games over the year. The current modern game being published is known as what is the Sabra rules, but you can still find the international and American rules out there. There are copies on Board Game Geek even. And Rummy Cub was actually the second game to ever win the Spiel des Jahres, making it a pretty solid classic in my book.
There you go. So Sean is pronouncing the name of the game completely wrong. It's actually Rummy Cube.
Okay.
No way.
I've never said that or heard that said in my life, but okay.
No, it looks like Rummy Cub. Cube. Why would it be cube? There's no E at the end.
It's not an English word, and the name of the game is Rummy Cube.
If you say so.
Look it up. That's the correct pronunciation.
I'm not going to look it up right now. I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt.
I was corrected by another podcaster when I said Rummy Cub once. So now it is my job to correct others the same way as Rummy Cube, even though it's not spelled that way.
There is a Rummy Cube, Q-U-B-E.
No, this is R-U-M-I-M-I-K-U-B. My next game, it's Steam Rails to Riches from 2009, Martin Wallace's train game. For years, I didn't care about train games. So, like, I knew they were a thing, right? I didn't realize the Power Grid started as a train game, but like I had no interest. I'm playing Catan, I'm playing Carcassonne, I'm playing thematic games, Ameritrash, and I'm like, why? Well, who cares about trains? What is with these board gamers and their trains, right? Then the Great Canadian Board Game Blitz comes to Windsor, and I participated. The final round, we had four of us left in the entire tournament. Deanna was at the table, as was our friend Jamie, and I forget who the fourth player was. It might have been Mike Easterbrook. And the game they present to us as for the finals is Steam. None of us had played it. Not a single one of us had ever played Steam before. So even though we're sitting at a tournament, had to learn the rules on the spot, both Dan and I fell in love with this route building, engine building, pick up and deliver mechanics in this now classic rail game. Now, since then, I found out train games are fun and train themed games can be fun. But since then, still, Steam Rails to Riches sticks out as my favorite.
Oh, yeah. No, I love that game. And I clearly remember playing it. There was one person at the table who had played it before. And he was trying to help us learn the rules, and he was not amused when he didn't, when he was not the person that won at the end of that round.
Yeah, Jamie ended up winning the tournament. I remember that much. Jamie beat both of us, well, all three of us.
Yeah, no, count me out for train games, but sure, it can be classic.
There you go. See, Sean needs to sit down and play Steam and then go, wow, actually.
Yeah, yeah. No, definitely. We got it.
This is going to turn into another list of the games we should introduce to Sean.
I got a notepad right over here, and all right. Yeah, the next one up is one that I've already forced Sean to play, Alien Frontiers from 2010. This was the first dice placement game that I tried, and I remember just being totally entranced with it. So when they did a Kickstarter reprint, I was totally on board. Mo's like, I'm thinking of buying this, and I'm like, oh, yes, please do. We haven't gotten it to the table in a while, but I still love this game, and I definitely think it stands the test of time. There was a 10th anniversary edition put out last year called Edition X, so I'm pretty sure it's still readily available, and it's a great game.
This was also one of the early Kickstarter successes in board gaming that kind of put the publisher on the map, Game Salute at the time, and they did a number of Kickstarters and kind of set up that, like, proved that a board game publisher could come into existence through crowdfunding. Mm-hmm. It was one of the early successes that actually went through.
Though those rocket ship dice were stupid. They just did not work.
Yeah, and that's kind of where things fell apart for that company, too. Overpromising on something they couldn't actually fulfill.
No, because that's never happened on Kickstarter. All right, so my next one is, and this one I'm sure is gonna bring up some opinions, but Connect Four. Now, some people are going to argue that this is about as much of a game as Tic-Tac-Toe. Now, I would argue that it is much more strategic, and I wonder how many people who, if placed near a game of Connect Four, would be able to avoid at least playing one game. Because part of the appeal of this game comes from the toyetic nature, the table presence, the physicality, the sound of the pieces clacking, the fun of opening the bottom to dump them all out before trying again. Is it the best game around? No. Does that stop it from being a classic? Also, no. In fact, just last week, you guys brought up Round 4, which mm-hmm. was the round variant of Connect 4. And I just recently discovered that there is a Connect 4 revised second edition that is out there right now, which not only plays Connect 4, but also plays Connect 5, as well as four other variants of the game, including the ability to push out your opponent's pieces, which really sort of brings it up to that next level and guarantees that it's not just a slightly bigger version of Tic-Tac-Toe.
All right, color me curious. I would try that. I'm amused by you saying about you put Connect 4 here and you avoid playing it. Definitely not once there's a few beers involved, which is why you see this game at breweries around the world.
Yeah, this is the game I have said many times, every coffee shop that wants me, any place that wants you to hang around and drink beverages, coffee shop, bars, pubs should have copies of Connect Four. All right, I'm going back a bit to 1989 for a game that many people lamented not being able to get for years, but is now back, and that is HeroQuest. This is the oldest game you're going to find on my list. I am talking about the original Milton Bradley Games Workshop collaboration. This is another one that's now resurrected. Not only going strong, though, and this is what's really impressing me, is not only did Hasbro bring it back through Pulse and through their Avalon Hill vertical or whatever they call that, their wing, they're putting out new stuff constantly. There is a stream of new HeroQuest content coming out every year, which is awesome. Now, what a lot of people don't realize, and I get this question all the time, is it the same? And yes, it is identical and to a fault, because there were mistakes in the original rulebook that they brought over to the new edition. The only thing that's changed is the look of the game, because they do not have licenses to the original Games Workshop art, so it no longer looks like the Warhammer world. You've got all new sculpts for the miniatures, all new sculpts for the scenery, and all new artwork on all the games, but the gameplay is identical. I love the fact that, like, HeroQuest is having a resurgence. Like, a new expansion was announced just this week, a brand new one that was never released, not another, you know, one that was only available in the EU that we're going to bring to North America. No, brand new content is coming out for HeroQuest now.
I'm kind of amused because this one absolutely fits under my definition for age and sort of lasting notability, but doesn't fall under the going to be forgotten because there's all this new content coming out constantly and Hasbro is pushing it down people's throats with you know, the way it was sold and all that stuff. So, I think it's classic. I'm just kind of surprised because it doesn't quite as much fall under your definition.
You know what? I think there was a lull in between where the game didn't exist and it wasn't in print, where it definitely qualified. Does it qualify now when it's got this huge hyped new version? Yeah.
What I don't know is if people are picking up the new stuff. Like I don't have sales figures or know how well
it's going. They have to be.
Right?
Hasbro doesn't make stuff that isn't going to sell. Because things are still coming out, someone's got to be buying it. I mean, enough people bought the new release to, you know, support it to some degree. I'm sure at some point it'll peter out, but
there's no way they would still be coming out with new expansions if there wasn't selling.
Unless they already paid to have made and everything, right? Like, how much did they go in on Pulse?
I don't know. I think we're far enough along now that window is closed.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking.
Fair enough. And to be fair, like, we just didn't have enough time. I was going to pull this one off the list once we talked about things. And I was going to replace it with St. Petersburg. So there, for Sean's sake, instead, I'll replace that with St. Petersburg. It was one of the classic Aaliyah games that got recent reprinting. Even the reprinting might be 10 years old at this point. That is a fantastic card drafting game, pure Euro, engine building, get your workers to get your money and then build buildings and build markets and rebuild the city of St. Petersburg that has just been burnt down. So there's an off-the-top replacement for HeroQuest. I'm going to throw out St. Petersburg because that's what I was going to replace HeroQuest with if I had time.
All right. Yeah, well,
I love that game. We've even actually kind of played it recently. So, yeah. Yep.
So speaking of Avalon Hill, back when you were still talking about HeroQuest, I think a game that can and should be considered a classic is Dune. Now re-released by Gale Force 9 in 2019 with the new movies, it kept the classic's well-loved aspects of the game while modernizing the look and feel of it to be more in line with modern expectations for gamers. And to be fair, it's not often you're going to find something that I would consider a classic with a weight of almost 4 out of 5.
All right. I'm just going to jump back a sec. I guess I failed. St. Petersburg, the second edition came out in 2014. So the second edition was 9 years old at this point.
All right. I'm going with Hey, That's My Fish. It's a family weight game that came out in 2003. If you haven't tried it, you should. I have so many fond memories of this game from playing it at coffee shops with Mo to it being one of the first more advanced games that I taught Gwen. I've played this literally hundreds of times with our kids, but also with adults. It's a solid game, one that deserves not to be forgotten. And there's a recent reprint that just came out, so you can definitely still get this one.
We've seen this one played at our recent gaming events at the Walkerville Brewery. It's been a big hit with a number of different players, including ones who thought they were grabbing Don't Break the Ice and ended up with something a little more cutthroat. I think it's a great game. It's kind of surprising to me that now it's like sold along with Uno and stuff in a small box. So I don't know if they made the chits smaller or just got rid of all the air in the box, but it's now a small box game. Now going back to HeroQuest and Classic Games Workshop games, another one that's still popular and still going fairly strong, but only in small communities, is Blood Bowl. The only reason this even ended up on the list is there is a local league that just launched just this past weekend, had their first event at Tabletop Renaissance, great local game store, and I was drooling over the pictures from this event. Now, the game has changed a lot over the years and now features more streamlined rules and quicker play, better suited to tournaments, mainly so you can do like a whole league day in one day instead of having to spread it over a weekend. And the desire to get my iced buns, the halfling team I created, back to the pitch is very strong. Since Dee's been tossing in some extra games with the recommendation, though, since we're doing that, I'm going to throw in Space Hulk as well. This one's not currently supported, but has been brought back, I think, 4 times so far by Games Workshop. So there's always a chance it'll come back, or maybe you'll be stuck with one of the previous 3 editions if they don't.
I'm all there for Space Hulk. Absolutely count that as classic for me. Blood Bowl is an interesting one. It's really had its hits and misses. It was being supported by the fans for so long with the living rule book. And then they dropped the version 3, the third edition, which really kind of got a lot of people's backs up and really kind of became divisive within the community, whether or not you liked the changes, which were, you know, drastic changes to some in some degree. In that third ed or not.
Actually, that's not even third ed. The current edition is actually called Blood Bowl Second Season.
Yeah.
Which is the fourth edition of the board game. I know the video game called that the third version, but the actual current printing is Blood Bowl Second Season Edition, which is available and supported by Games Workshop, not the fans. But then Games Workshop went and shut down all the living stuff, which is, I think, mainly what pissed people off, more so than any changes in the new edition, just that they took this fan thing and brought it back into the fold, which I understand knowing some IP law.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you Blood Bowl, but I enthusiastically support Space Hulk.
We got to do that. To be fair, I bought one of the reprints they put out over the years. I think it was the first of the four. Mm-hmm. We should sit down and play that. We never played it. Like, we got it.
We did. We played it once, didn't we?
Did we?
I swear we did. It. Only once, but I swear we played it.
Yeah. I don't know. The miniatures are still up here on my shelf, but the box is behind me.
I got one. Shadows over Camelot, 2005. And this one, I think, is starting to feel like it's truly been forgotten. It's out of print. It's rare. It's hard to find at this point. But when it first came out, it was wildly popular, at least around here. And I think for many folks, it was their first cooperative, we're all going to play together to beat the game sort of experience. And it was, I think, also one of the first well-known games with the hidden traitor thing. So I think that sets it apart and makes it a classic.
Yeah, well, most people consider it is the first cooperative board game, like the first big co-op game, which I'm like, hidden traitor to me. To me, it's not a co-op game, it's hidden traitor. But that's what a lot of people give Shadows Over Camelot credit to, is making cooperative board games popular before pandemic hit, right? Once pandemic hit, not the pandemic, but pandemic the board game, Shadows Over Camelot was the shining example of cooperative games.
But you could play it both ways, and we did play it both ways, with and without the traitor. So that's why I feel like it does get that cooperative game badge.
I have played Shadows of Camelot, but it has been some time, so my memory is colored by history. But it's one of those games where it's like everyone talks about it fondly, and I'm like, it was fun. I probably wouldn't turn it down, but I don't know.
To be very honest, it's a cooperative game. It was one of the first experiences I had with cooperative games. Did I love it? No, not really. But I still think it's a classic. And for folks that do enjoy that genre, it deserves a look.
All right. I, of course, before we finish up, have to include one of my favorite games of all time. That is Wallenstein from 2002. The first ever game to use a cube tower for battle resolution. I adore this Waro, and that's a mashup of folk on a map, war game, and Euro game. You've got programmed movement where you have to decide what you're going to do in your different provinces. You've got some resource management. You've got buildings. There's area control, not majority, and more. This was, of course, followed up not too long after by Shogun. And I love both, but I think Wallenstein is better for experienced players because it's a little more interactive, a little harder to turtle on because the maps, more provinces are touching each other. Now, if you're new to this series, I'll introduce you to Shogun. Just ask. Then we'll bring out Wallenstein and really go to it.
So I wanted to highlight Orléans, which is from 2014, and that's 10 years ago. So that makes it qualifies, right? The buzz around this one seems to have totally faded, but it was such a big hit when it came out. It's a fantastic game, and I think it popularized the whole bag builder mechanic.
So I don't think this one disappeared because there's a brand new expansion out and everyone's talking about it.
Oh, well, see, I'm in a hole. I haven't heard anyone chat about it in a while, and I was thinking of it because I dig this game.
I haven't actually heard much about it other than us talking about it from time to time since
Plague. Trade and, I think it might be Plague. I'm trying to figure out what the latest expansion is.
See, it's interesting because I'm really interested in taking a look back. So in 5 years, 10 years,
yes.
Taking a look back at some of these games that we consider modern classics, and I'm going to jump myself in here. Some of these are absolutely modern classics. But finding out whether or not any of them actually hold weight. Like, we are probably going to continue remembering a lot of these games fondly because we have enjoyed them. But if you take them to a newer board game group in, you know, 10 years from now, put Orléans or, you know, El Grande in front of these newer gamers? Are they gonna find them classics, or are they just gonna be like, "Wow, what has Grandpa brought?" It'd be interesting to see which games make the jump from a modern classic that we think of as that to the longer standing classic, you know, ageless classic.
Evergreen.
Like trying to get our kids to play the original Zelda games. Yeah. I should put El Grande in front of Gwen and see what her reaction is.
I don't know. Like, that's something else. Our show is now old enough. We could do look backs at games we played 5 years ago and talk about if we still care, which is something other podcasts have been around for a long time have been doing. There's another segment I would love to throw in the show. So it is Orléans. The Plague expansion that was just released from Capstone Games, which is who owns Orléans now. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I've been seeing all kinds of hype on this because this just came out.
All right. So we have had a lot of engagement in the lobby here.
Yes.
Folks have been chatting away. Thank you very much for all of that. I'm going to start off with going back to right at the beginning where Tabletop Express, thank you, mentioned the classic to me is different than modern classic. When I say classic, I automatically think of Stratego, but maybe that's retro now. Dominion, Carcassonne stand out. Azul hits the modern classic vibe, although Azul is pretty new for our list, even.
I think. Azul's too new for our list tonight, because I looked it up. I'm like, how old is Azul? Though, again, like Deanna said, some games are only 5 years old feel like modern classics, and I think that's where Azul fits.
Riding Paul Ryan's asking, would you consider Struggle of Empires a classic?
Yes, I think so. All I know is Eugene and Ernie and Neil were always begging me to play that with. And that was like years ago when we were hanging around with Eugene regularly. So
it must have been out there for a while.
Yeah, 2004. I'm like, it's old. It's a classic Martin Wallace game. Imperialism, right? Like it's problematic thematically, but you know, take over Europe kind of game, Struggle of Empires. It's like I said, they always call it Struggles. You play some Struggles. You got to come to Ernie's, play some Struggles. We're not Joe's. Come to Joe's, play some Struggles. Do you want to play some Struggles? To me, I would consider that a classic.
So Eggman Jr. brings up Talisman, classic game, yes, with the fifth edition releasing soon.
Yeah, I just saw the announcement of that today. I wonder if they'll change anything. I will say that some of the things, like we checked out the Batman version of Talisman, and they had done quite a bit to streamline the game from the classic that I still enjoy. I have the second edition, and I have everything for the second edition, including 80% of the miniatures for it. And it's been a while now, but I like to break that out now and then and play it. But for me, that's more nostalgia. And honestly, I kind of miss that kind of sandbox style game. Doesn't seem to exist anymore. And yes, I realize there were problems with it, with roll and move, and it could go on forever. But there doesn't seem to be like explore the fantasy map and have random encounters and level up to do the big boss fight at the end anymore. It's all very scripted. It's all dungeon crawlers now and app driven and fits in 1 hour session where you complete an adventure and then come back and play more. And I kind of miss that style of game.
Although RuneQuest
is the only other modern one.
Horizons. That was basically
just fights. It was three fights. There was no wandering. There was no exploration. Mm-hmm. There were no choices.
There were choices in how you outfitted yourself. And I mean, no, it's not the full map. I mean, there was only so much you could do, but it was definitely a long, drawn out, multiple battles in order to build up for the big bad boss that you knew was coming. But
it was just the battles. There was none of the exploration and run into a stranger and you happen to find a clay pot and then you give the clay pot to this guy and it becomes a better item and you found a sword, like all that part was missing. It was good for the campaign battles.
I'm with Mo on this one, not Horizon. Sorry, Sean.
Tabletop Express mentions Labyrinth. It's a bit of both. It's from the 80s, but modernized with new themes in 2024. Okay.
Sorry, I thought you were talking Jim Henson's Labyrinth, and I'm like, heck no. Sorry, you're talking about the Ravensburger. I'm all good. Mm-hmm. Ravensburger Labyrinth is great. Again, our last event at the Walkerville Brewery, or there was a group playing Pokemon Labyrinth.
Pandemic.
That's certainly a classic.
Classic with that criteria, absolutely. Yes. Illuminati is being nominated by Red Meeple Ryan.
He's a fanboy. I'll give it to Ryan. It's a modern classic to you. I never enjoyed that game. My dad had it. It's a classic Steve Jackson games, originally released as a trading card game collectible to compete with Magic, but then they were like, forget it here, just buy a box, get all the cards and play. It had some neat things going on. But I can't think of, like, there's no string of Illuminati likes that came after it either. Not in my mind. Sorry, Ryan. That one's not for me.
And he mentions Hacker, which used the same mechanism in a different way.
Okay, so there's at least one, but I think that's also Steve Jackson Games.
Mm-hmm. Tabletop Express mentioning incredible memories of the Scrabble Club.
I don't think there's a Scrabble Club at either of our kids' schools, or is Chess Club still?
Castles of Burgundy, mentioned by Eggman Jr.
Is that old enough? I guess it should be, right? They did a 10th anniversary.
El Grande.
I don't know. I could be like every Stefan Feld game from 2014 and earlier.
Grande,
there aren't very many bad ones in there.
Carcassonne. There we go. Eggman Jr. says Crokinole is a classic by any definition.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I forgot Castles of Burgundy is that old. I would have definitely put it on my list.
Nuclear War, the 50th anniversary was in 2013. Yeah. Wealth of Nations, one of the first games Ryan can recall having dual-layer boards.
I don't think I ever played that one. Train game.
What role do classics play in also inspiring new games and the evolution?
That could be an interesting discussion.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to get into that right now. But no, what's the question?
I'll note it down so we might come back to it.
What role do classics play in also inspiring new games and the evolution? Megman Jr. points out a lot of the 80s games were not good by today's standards.
Player agency, interesting decisions. Those were missing.
As a bit of a definition here... At the least, something that has been around enough to become a staple in a collection or common enough knowledge among the player base that it is still remembered. That could go deeper depending on the age of the players, of course. Redwood Ryan's asking if Merchant of Venus is worthy of being a classic now.
Yes.
Over a decade old.
Definitely. It's more than a decade old. Merchant of Venus is like 50 years old. Oh, okay. I'm like, Merchant of Venus is like 60s, isn't it? Merchant of Venus. How old is Merchant of Venus?
Seriously? Is it that old?
Merchant of Venus, 88. I thought it was older than that.
I'm like, 60s? No way.
Merchant of Venus definitely fits. They had both editions. Well, the new edition actually comes with the original as well.
Like, there was a lot of discussion going on. Absolutely. It's fantastic. Red Meepore, I mentioned, I missed the original Descent.
Here's one
we got Twilight Imperium 3. We got Food Chain Magnet coming up.
Yeah, Survive, which is now printed.
Survive, that's a fantastic. Survive, unfortunately, is dead again. You cannot get Survive. It is long out of print. Hmm. That was kept alive by Stronghold Games for a very long time.
There's no more Escape from Atlantis?
Nope. It is dead now.
I remember playing someone else's copy of that.
That one's old. That might be 60s. How old is Survive? 82. I knew it was old. I just couldn't remember how long.
You keep wanting to put everything back into the 60s. Came out when I was a child. Must have been 1960-something. Okay.
Yeah, Ryan called a Rex is what you really want if you want the recreation of Dune. That was the Gale Force 9, that was the Fantasy Flight reprint of Avalon Hill's Dune. That was a streamlined version. I don't know. There's too many versions of Dune have been reprinted by different publishers at this point.
I mean, honestly, if we just went with 10 years old and it's a good game and nobody's talking about it, we could have put 100 games on this list.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, I noticed that. From like 2010 to 2013, there is a ridiculous amount of awesome games that were released.
It's almost like it was the renaissance of tabletop gaming. At the same time, though,
I wonder how much of that is colored by you and who you are and when you were gaming and how you got into gaming versus whether or not you'd give that to a newer gamer and they would agree with you. I don't know. I honestly don't. But I think it's an interesting experiment. A lot
of those games are still being printed and still being sold, and there's got to be a reason. Some of them, when they're not, I think, some of them they just faded, and there's a reason they faded. But sometimes games companies close, IPs were involved that, you know, there's disputes there, and then things don't get reprinted for those reasons. And those are the classics that just kind of crumble away somewhere and need to get talked about, but you can't go pick up a copy. So I'm so sorry. Enjoy your Shadows over Camelot.
You know how much we love the Holiday Hijinks line of 18-card escape room games from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild? Well, we've got something new to be hyped about. The new Endangered Rescue line.
Galapagos Penguins is title number one in the Endangered Rescue line, a new series of 18-card escape room-style games.
As host of the conservation TV show Wild World, you're currently in the Galapagos Islands filming a special in order to bring attention to the plight of the endangered Galapagos penguin. Suddenly, your production tent is ransacked. Your hopes of helping the penguins are in jeopardy, and time is running out to complete your production. Who did this? What are their motivations?
You'll have to act quickly to solve puzzles, fix equipment, and navigate the island in order to finish your show and help save the Galapagos penguin.
Endangered Rescue Number 1 will be premiering at Origins 2024. You can pre-order it at GrandGamersGuild.com and use code ORIGINS, O-R-I-G-I-N-S, to save on shipping and pick it up at the con. You can find the Grand Gamers Guild booth at 1233. That's 1233.
And if you're not attending Origins, no worries. You can just pop in our bellhop code, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, and save 10% on your shipped order.
Finally, we would still love it if you headed over to the Board Game Geek Origins preview list and gave all the Grand Gamers Guild games a thumbs up. You can use the link that we're just dropping into the chat or find the one in our show notes. And now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games we play of late.
So with our oldest daughter getting dental surgery, there hasn't been a lot of time for family game night, and there were no get-togethers or public events this last week. So most of my gaming this past week was done sitting on the couch, keeping Gwen company, and watching her play Tearaway Unfolded for, I don't know which time she's on, a fifth, sixth, seventh time. I don't know. They're obsessed with this game. We actually got like a review copy years ago, and they keep playing it. And this time she's determined she's going to 100% it. She also was playing Ratchet and Clank Drift Apart, or she traded off and sometimes just wanted to watch as she was dozing in and out. And I ended up actually finishing Horizon Forbidden West, the Burning Shores DLC. And then she had me start up Spider-Man 2. So we've been playing some video games, but not a lot of tabletop gaming.
Yeah, I got to go back and revise my Tearaway Unfolded review that I published years ago on Maple Leaf Mommy to say that my daughter feels the need to complete it for a fourth time. I guess it's her comfort game now. I don't know.
It is.
But yeah, it's been pretty quiet on the gaming front this week. Nothing hitting the table.
Yeah, I'm back on Diablo 4, but nothing tabletop.
So what we did manage to fit in tabletop-wise was KAPOW from Wize Wizard Games. So I don't even know which volume we grabbed, but what I wanted to do is we will be reviewing this one tonight, and be prepped for the review. I wanted to make sure we'd tried it solo. So I sat down and played it solo, and it was good. It was surprisingly good. I had a feeling this was going to be good solo just because there's a big puzzle aspect to the game on trying to figure out the best way to position your dice. And I thought that would come through. Plus, I really liked how quick it was solo because you're doing everything yourself. Deanna tried it as well. We even have a recording of a video of her playing it, though I'm not sure how well that turned out yet. We haven't looked at it.
Yeah, it recorded. I'm going to have to edit the heck out of it to get it down to something short enough to post online, which is a huge time suck. But yes, theoretically, there is a video.
KAPOW's been so much fun every time we played it. You'll hear more about it in the video in the review coming up.
Yeah, I'll quickly say I did enjoy playing it solo, and I'm going to leave the rest for the review.
Is that like your first solo game, D?
The first one since I've decided to be a vocal face on the show, definitely. My first solo game ever? No, I don't think so. There's other stuff you've encouraged me to come and play while you were playing it or after you played it. I'm just drawing a blank right now.
All right, I just thought of it. I'm like, that might have been your first solo board game. So now another thing we do want to talk about that is tabletop related. And sorry for those of you overseas or down south, this is for the locals. Though in the coming years, you might want to make the trip this way. Is the other day we were talking about Bellhop Con and a potential con in Windsor. And we checked out the venue for an entertainment convention that we are going to be part of. This is coming up on July 20th. It's going to be at St. Clair College. We will be running the board game area for that event, which is going to include open gaming area with a curated list of games to play. Anyone who's been to our Walkerville events, it'll be familiar. We'll have a menu and we'll have those games on hand and people that'll be able to teach it. Plus, we're going to have, and I think this is going to be the big draw for the locals, is a selection of 10 or more play-to-win games. So those will be games that are sitting out on a table and you play them and you kind of note down that you played it. And at the end of the night, we'll give away all those games to one of the people drawn randomly who played the game during the day.
Yeah, it's just a one day event. And I don't remember the exact hours that they're setting because like we're coming in to just run the board gaming part of this. But it is the full day and they're talking about having cornhole, All kinds of CCG tournaments, a rock wall climbing thing, jelly bowl. I don't know. I don't even know how much tickets are going to be. I am lacking in details because everything is still in flux and all the details are being worked out. But the one thing we can say for certain is there is going to be a convention in Windsor at St. Clair College on July 20th, and we will definitely be there hosting the board game area for the event. And we're going to run it like a big open game area with tons of provided games to pick from, much like what we do at Walkerville Brewery. And like Mo said, we're also planning on having a bunch of play-to-win games. I am super excited about this. I think it's going to be awesome. Yeah.
More information as we get it. We'll definitely be talking about it here, as well as sharing it in our usual Windsor groups. Check the Windsor Gaming Resource group on Facebook, our Discord. Follow my social account, stuff like that. You'll be able to hear more about this event as we learn more. And sadly, that's about all we've been up to gaming related recently. So what about you? What have you been up to? What games hit your table this past week? Love to hear about it in the comments. You can tag me on social media, where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Do you remember the collectible dice game Dragon Dice from TSR? Well, it's still around and still plays pretty much the same, though they did remove some of the annoying collectible aspects of the game. Thank the gods.
Company behind Dragon Dice's resurrection and continued longevity is SFR Inc., who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. They now own the rights to the original TSR game, along with all the art as well. This has allowed them to not only reprint all the classic material, but also create new content. For a game I thought was long dead, there's an awful lot of stuff out there.
The one specific bit of that content that we're looking at today is the two-player starter set Firewalker versus Treefolk. This is a small box that contains everything you need to jump into the world of Dragon Dice. It works as a standalone game, as a core set to start you on your army building journey, and is fully compatible with everything else Dragon Dice that is out there, both new and old.
This starter set allows you to play two-player games of Dragon Dice and includes a set of simplified introductory rules from designers Chris Shep Shepherdson and Lester Smith. The game artwork is from the late Janelle Jaques.
In Dragon Dice, you recreate an epic fantasy duel fought over three fronts. Your units are represented by different dice, including D6 troops, D10 monsters, and D12 dragons. The center of each battlefield is a D8 terrain die. First player to use their troops to control two of the three terrain dice wins. Now, this starter set features two armies, Firewalkers and Treefolk, each of which has 30 health with their units, two terrain dice, and two dragons each. Note the Firewalkers are one of the classic Dragon Dice armies from TSR's era, but the Treefolk are totally new with the SFR version of the game.
You can get a look at all of these dice, plus the fold-out battlefield playmats and the simplified rules, by checking out our Dragon Dice 2-player starter set unboxing video over on YouTube. And if you go there, you'll see Mo also shows off a very cool Dragon Dice battle mat that we also got from SFR, but you just need to be aware that the rollout vinyl mat doesn't actually come with a 2-player starter set. It's something you can buy separately.
Now, they managed to fit a whole lot into this little box, including 40 dice. The problem being the box is so little that the rule book is folded in half, as are the playmats, and it's going to take some work to get either to lay flat. The dice are very well crafted with etched symbols, though they aren't the easiest to read. More on that later.
So to play a game of Dragon Dice with this starter set, each player chooses one of the two armies and collects all the dice for that army. They split up the D12 Dragon Dice evenly. Each player places a fold-out playmat in front of them, so the two are touching to create an overall army battlefield.
Players split their army up into three forces, one for each of the three battlefields, a home army, a campaign army, and a horde army. Each player also selects one terrain die for their home area and a prospective terrain die for the campaign area. This is all done without the other player seeing what you're choosing, and both players reveal their final choices simultaneously.
Despite the dice looking similar and all of an army's dice being the same color, they are actually split up into various units, including heavy and light melee, cavalry, missile, and magic. The main face of each die indicates its type. Each troop features a different mix of symbols representing magic, missile, melee, maneuver, and save. The face of each die is wild and counts as whatever you are trying to roll for.
The size of each die indicates its health. Small dice are 1 health, medium 2, and large 3.
Now, each army in this box also includes 2 monsters. These are represented by D10 dice and have 4 health. Now, in addition to the basic symbols, monster dice also include special action icons called SAIs. Each of these does something different, and you're going to have to look up what they do in the book to figure out what it is. For example, the Treefolk have a unit called the Redwood, which has a trample ability. Well, tramples count as either melee or maneuver symbols when rolled.
Everyone's revealed armies are placed into the appropriate battlefields, and both players roll their horde army. The player who rolled the most maneuver symbols now has a choice. They can choose to use their terrain die for the campaign battlefield, or they can go first. If they choose to go first, their opponent then gets to place their chosen terrain die for the campaign battlefield.
On a player's turn, they get to activate 2 of their armies. Note, an army is all of the dice in 1 battlefield, not just a single die. With your chosen army, you first get the option to maneuver.
Now, maneuvering is how you change the value on those terrain dice. You can roll it up or down, but you don't have to declare which way you plan on going when you announce your maneuvering.
The opponent gets the option to oppose. If they choose not to, then you just get to change the die. If they oppose, both players roll their armies. If the active player gets more maneuvers than the opponent, they get to roll the terrain die.
If you roll a terrain die up to 8, you now control that terrain and move it towards your side of the battlefield. You win the game by controlling 2 of the 3 terrain dice.
Next, the active player can activate their army to take the action that's now showing on the terrain die where they are. These actions are either magic, missile, or melee. If you control the terrain, you get to choose which of those 3 actions to use. Otherwise, you're forced to use the action shown on the die. For each of these rolls, you roll your army and count up the number of matching symbols for that action. For example, if you roll a bunch of missile attacks, you just add up the number of missile symbols you rolled. Now, for each magic point generated by a magic action, you will get to cast spells, and I'm not getting into the details here other than to say there's a full spell list in the rulebook.
Missile actions are targeted on either the opponent's army at the location you're at or at an adjacent battlefield. Each missile counts as 1 health worth of damage. The opponent gets to roll, hoping for saves, each save negating 1 damage. Any damage that's left over has to be taken by the opponent, moving dice to the graveyard.
Melee attacks are similar, but can only be targeted at an army at your location. Plus, after the opponent rolls saves and takes damage, they get to counterattack, with the initial attacker rolling for saves.
After activating 2 units, the active player has the option to move units to and from their reserves. They can move any number of units from any of the battlefields to the reserve and or any units already in the reserve to one of the battlefields.
And that's pretty much all you need to know to get the general gist of how Dragon Dice plays. Play continues with the next player activating 2 armies and only ends when 1 player controls 2 out of 3 terrain dice or all of their opponent's troops are wiped out.
There is, of course, a lot more going on here. With all of the spells, the ability to summon dragons with your magic, dragons are neutral and are placed on the battlefield and attack both players, player units in their turn. Rules for promoting units, a ton of special actions, special action icons, doing all kinds of things, and of course, the spell lists. Each army is made of 2 colors, which gives them access to spells from both those domains.
Then there's the fact this is the starter set. These are actually simplified rules. Once you know the game, you can check out the full rules at the SFR's site. They're available free in PDF, or you can actually go out and purchase a separate rulebook if you wish. Now, the full rules include army-specific abilities that make the terrain dice more important, which I thought was really weird weren't in the starter set. Rules for items, rules for artifacts, new types of dice, dragonborn, and all kinds of additional rules.
And finally, there's the army building aspect. This set comes with 2 complete armies, but there are now 14 different factions available for Dragon Dice, and you're free to mix and match forces, though there is an advantage to sticking to fewer unit types and matching your colors.
The good thing about how SFR is doing this is that you no longer have to buy blind packs containing random dice split over all the armies. Now you can start the game with this set or do a make-your-own faction starter at SFR. Then you can buy expansions or kickers to add to your chosen armies and get additional terrain dice. Now, there's still randomness here, as each kicker contains 1 monster and 7 troops, but at least you know that all the dice will be from the same army.
So the important thing to know about Dragon Dice is that it's basically a miniature battle game that uses dice and has all of the army building and collecting that goes along with playing a miniature battle game. While this is no Warhammer, to really enjoy Dragon Dice involves committing to it, learning the different unit types, learning the various monsters, the different dragon types, figuring out what terrain dice are best with your army, figuring out combos between different factions, and so on.
That's a good comparison. This is very much a miniature battle game where instead of wee plastic dudes, your units are made up of nifty dice in various sizes, shapes, and colors. It's also got a wee bit of the CCG thing with the random packs.
Yeah, it's interesting. This game, it's odd to me to find it come with a two-player starter kit, because unless you're a couple who live together, it's not useful as that. It's basically just two armies for you, because this is not a game where you can easily sit down and start playing it with somebody. It's, again, it like an army-building game, thought and effort needs to go into this. And there's a lot of information in that rule book that you need to reference throughout the game. Only having one copy of that is problematic.
Yeah, where I think the starter set does shine is your way to kind of check out Dragon Dice and find out if the game's worth it for you if you want to dive further. Because you do, you get two full armies, and the starter rules give you a good feel of the game. Yeah, they lack the details and some of the full rules, but there's more than enough here to make that decision of, will I enjoy this? Was this fun? Do I want to dive deeper? I honestly think one play of the starter set, most people are going to be able to tell if the game's for them or not.
Totally. I feel like this is a great intro set, the perfect way to figure out if the game is right for you or not. Before you dive into something that's collectible and has random elements, you can figure it out and then figure out if you want to enter into that pit or not.
Yeah, I don't necessarily know that it shows it off as best as it could. But I think it is it is the best they've got by far of how to start this off.
Yeah, because it's rough, right? Like there's a learning curve. There's a steep learning curve. There's a lot going on here, and there's a lot of symbols to learn and a lot of moving parts. And it kind of stinks that your first decision in the game is split up your army and or split up your battle force into three separate armies. Like if you've never played before, you're just kind of like, I don't know what this does or what this means or what this is for. Why would I split them this way? What does it matter where I'm putting people, right? It's overwhelming. You're like basically thrown into the water.
Yeah, I think we were talking before about games that are best learned by the lore of people passing it on to other players. Yeah. This feels like that kind of game. A game where watching someone else play through a full game first would be really helpful. Or like you're going to get it so much better if someone that already knows the game sits you down and teaches it, because this is a rough one to dive into.
Yeah, at the very least, giving someone the rule book and saying, go take, 20 minutes, half an hour and read through the rule book is probably something that would certainly help, because there's just too much information to download. No matter how good of a teacher you are, there's just so much information, and because the armies are asymmetrical, that adds a whole other layer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, honestly, what I think this SFR could use and would be a great resource for them is something like the Master Tailor's Poltergeist for Aventuria, a literal demo kit with a ten minute version of the game. That like at least shows you, I don't know, maybe there's just one battlefield and it just shows you, here's how you maneuver, here's how you do a melee attack, here's how you do a ranged attack, here's how you use magic. Boom, now you got the basics. Okay, let's play to the full game. Now, the other problem that applies to the starter set and honestly everything Dragon Dice, and this goes back to the TSR days of the game, is these symbols. They are archaic. They're mystic looking or something. I don't know why they did this. I have to assume someone at TSR thought it was thematic to have every single army use different symbols for the same basic things. Every army has its own unique symbol for melee and its own unique symbol for archery. Or I forget what missile. Sorry, a unique symbol for missile and a unique symbol for magic. And SFR has kept that up. The armies they produce, the Treefolk, are the same thing. And honestly, the game would play better if I could just quickly look at any die and go, well, yeah, I have three melee sides on this and I have two maneuver. I don't have to look over and go, is that a foot or a branch or is that a spear?
But yeah, it wouldn't look as cute on the table. I mean, it's got a nice look to it. It's thematic. But I agree. It definitely makes things more complicated than they need to be.
I don't think it's cute. Thematic, maybe. But just today, I was editing the video for Mo's unboxing as Mo held up these dice and said, oh, here's a wing and here's the dragon head. And I still couldn't identify most of what he was holding up. Maybe it's just me, and maybe it's a certain visual processing thing. I don't know. I've still never seen one of those 3D puzzles you stare at and see things either. Never happened for me. But
sailboat.
I don't ever, you know, these dice make no sense to me. And I spent a good portion of our game trying to figure out what the heck I had just rolled, because I played Tree Men and the symbols are completely different than the Firewalker symbols. So Mo had rolled, you know, oh, I've got three maneuver. Well, that's great. I rolled something, but none of my symbols match what any of your symbols are. So I got nothing.
Now, to be fair, with a copy of the rule book that does show you what all the sides are on every die and you can see what the different symbols are. But there's only, again, one copy of this. So it's not like, give me a reference card or something with each army to show me the different types. And I will say the hardest face to read is the face, like the symbol. And honestly, it doesn't really matter as long as you know it's the face. But yes, there are a couple of the dice. I still can't quite see the elf with the two stars around its head. I can't get it right. But you don't need to see that. You just have to know that's the face side, as opposed to the one with two to three symbols on it.
It just seems if it doesn't matter what the face is, which it doesn't, then why does it need to be a fancy face? Like, it just seems extraneous to go to all this effort and to all this graphic design effort and cost for something that really only makes it more complex than it needs to be.
Yeah. Well, it's TSR, it's D&D. Come on, you need your elf units to look different. The elf cavalry can't look the same as the elf archer.
And then the dice size, the dice shape, and the dice color are all different. They're not.
The dice size, shape, and color are all identical for those units. That's the part that's hard.
I would argue it would make the game less visually appealing if they all look the same. Maybe cute's the wrong word, but there's an aesthetic there. It isn't a nice look. But is it a practical look? No.
So I personally got into Dragon Dice back when it was first released. I played with my dad, some of my gaming group, though I was the one who bought all the dice, right? Like Sean was saying about you, like you almost need a household for this. Yeah, I was the dice guy. I was the one that owned all the armies. It'd be like, you know, playing Warhammer and having five armies on hand in case anyone wanted to come over and play. I had fond memories of the game, and I was surprised that it stands up. I still enjoy this game. I had a lot of fun with it. Now, I already knew about the symbol issues and had kind of gotten over those with the old ones. And yes, I have dice that I've owned for 30 years that I still can't quite see the symbol on them. But it's still basically the same game. Now, SFR has added some new things to the game, and they have balanced it and clarified the rules. So there are tweaks. But to be fair, I didn't take out one of my old rule books and compare it paragraph to paragraph. So I can't. You know, this is not a comparison of the old to the new. I will just say it feels the same as the old version.
I think it's flipping fantastic that the old dice work with the new game. I love that they tried to make it all mesh together.
Yeah, absolutely. It makes sense in so many ways to have the continuity because, I mean, it was TSR. There are going to be a lot of these dice out there. There are going to be a lot of fans of the game who were sad to see it go. I mean, this game even had a computer game back in the Windows 95 days. It was a major thing, and I'm sure there were a lot of people sad to see it go.
Now, I will say it's a product of its time. It has that feel. This feels like an old TSR game. It has an old fantasy battle game vibe to it. It's honestly kind of ridiculous when you look at it, and to even produce that many different armies with their own unique art, and the fact that someone decided that the goblin maneuver should look like little goblin footprints, meanwhile the tree folk look like paw prints in the snow or something. Like, and this is a very random game. This is a dice game. This is a game for fans of rolling lots of dice. Plus, while the gameplay isn't that bad, you get really fiddly and detail-oriented when you get into spellcasting and spending spell points on lists. Like, the number of spell options in this game for something that may not even happen unless your terrain dice roll really low at the beginning of the game, there's an awful lot of time spent on a spellcasting system.
Yeah, it's a fiddly game, period. It's a game you're not just going to play once or twice. This is a, you got to deep dive and get to know it kind of game, which, again, makes it seem like Warhammer or other miniature battle games. The same sort of level of commitment is required to play it, really.
Yeah, I think commitment is really the key here. Need to be able and willing to take the time to learn the symbols on your dice, to learn about the spells that you can cast, to learn about the SAIs that your army or armies have, and think about the strategies involved in that. You're not just going to sit down and say, oh, hey, I'm going to play this army today, because... Yeah. You're going to have a rough time, even if you are familiar with another army, say. Sitting down with a brand new army for the first time, there's a learning curve right there, even.
Now, again, the one advantage here over Warhammer is no painting, no assembly, no scenery to make, no 8 or 3 by, I don't know what size you play Warhammer anymore. Back in the day when I played Warhammer, it was 8x4 table was required. This is a heck of a lot less buy-in for even a skirmish miniature game comparatively. If you think of it as, you know, mass battle army game, you just got to buy a couple sets of dice or honestly a 2-player starter set. Now, I will call out that ability if you go to SFR to build your own. So you get together with a friend, you each pick an army, you order the 2-player starter set for those two armies and get going. Overall, I'm kind of glad we stumbled into the SFR Dragon Dice booth. It was a game I did not know was still there. I spotted the booth by giant dice that they had set up at their booth, and I'm like, oh my gosh, those look like dragon dice. Oh my gosh, it is dragon dice. This game scratches a nostalgic itch for me, but then ended up actually being more fun than I remember it being. The issue, though, is that commitment required, right? Like, you're not just going to buy it. You could go buy this starter set and play whatever 4, 5, 10 games of dragon dice, but to really enjoy it, you've got to commit further. Like, even grabbing my old dice, I would have a hard time making a good army out of them. And I will say the game is tempting me to dive into it more. I want to pick up some kickers for my goblins. I used to love the goblins. Or get some appropriate terrain dice that feat the army so that I can use their abilities better. The problem that brings is right now, at least for our local gaming community, as far as I know, I'd be the only one taking the plunge. And without local players, I'd be the one buying all the dice. And as we just learned with Sean playing the game, just tossing the game at a new player is honestly not a good way to get them interested.
Yeah, I do love that you can pick which armies to buy now as opposed to just getting a totally random assortment. I think that really helps with the whole army building. That other problem of how to introduce the game to new players, I'm kind of stumped. I think you need to find someone else who's already into the game and then play it loudly and obviously in public. And there's... get folks interested that way, because it's a visual game. People are going to be like, what the heck are you doing with those dice?
Yeah, I mean, I think bringing it to the right places, you know, going to the places where the tabletop people are playing skirmish games and battle games and things like that is probably a good start of a way to get people interested, because they're the folks who like getting that kind of involved into a dice building situation. From personal experience, saying, hey, let's play a game and sitting down to play this game isn't fun, especially because I don't have the nostalgia for the game. I didn't play this game in its original TSR version, so I wasn't even incentivized to get back into it. It was just kind of a, oh, look, there's a whole bunch of things that makes no sense to me.
If you're someone who collects dice, which many gamers are, if you just love your pretty plastic math rocks, that's just your jam, you might want to check out Dragon Dice just to get some really cool dice. Now, one thing we haven't mentioned, though, that is important is there are no numbers on these dice. So unlike some other customizable dice games out there, you cannot also use these dice as a standard set of dice for your RPGs or board games. I got to say, what got me to try Dragon Dice was because I was like, ooh, pretty dice with cool symbols on them. And look, dwarf dice and goblin dice. And I ended up liking the game as much as just having some cool looking dice.
They're pretty. Like, they're just pleasant. There's a nice tactile thing. They're nice and heavy. It's dice with lots of cool icons. It's inherently attractive to me.
Now, if you are into games, you know, other games like Warhammer Battles or other battle type games of the fantasy style, and if you like the TSR or Lord of the Rings aesthetic, this is a great game because you don't need to get into the painting and the miniature building and the top. It doesn't take up a lot of space. It's just nice. You know, you can play it at a larger coffee shop table if you want to. So you are saving on a whole lot of the other stuff that goes along with getting into games like that by just having the dice in front of you.
Yep. And honestly, if you're like me, if you played Dragon Dice in the back, and you have someone else willing to play it, pick up the starter. Like, this is a great way to dive back into Dragon Dice. And it's fully compatible with the old sets. Or even possibly better, go to SFR's website and do that special pre-order where you pick the two armies you want in your set.
The fully compatible thing here is just amazing. SSR gets a gold star for the backwards compatibility.
Everyone else is going to have to make up their own mind. Like, this is a lifestyle game, right? It's a bit of a lifestyle game. It requires investment of a collectible card game or a full-on miniature game. Yeah, you don't have the full hobby, but this is an army-building war game that's going to reward rule knowledge and owning a curated collection, not just a bunch of random dice.
And that's it for a review. Dragon Dice, two-player starter set, Firewalker versus Treefolk. Classic game that's still going strong, which was a surprise to us. What's a game you discovered is still going strong that you thought was long dead? Tell us all about it in the comments.
Well, they say an army survives on its stomach. Well, we survive on coffee. Help keep us caffeinated and motivated by buying us a coffee at ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. In the past, every time we talked about great two-player games, someone would recommend we try out Targi from KOSMOS. Well, we did, and everyone is right.
Firstly, thanks to KOSMOS Games for sending us a review copy of Targi. It's not often publishers are willing to send us games that are more than 10 years old, though that is a good indication of their confidence in this game that has stood the test of time.
Andreas Steger is the designer of Targi, which features artwork from Tara Akitsu, Franz Vowinkel. There's an end missing in there. I hate everything right now. All right. Secondly, thanks to the people that told us to try the game. But Andreas Steger is the designer of Targi, which features artwork from Tara Akitsu and Franz Vowinkel. Compared to many of the two-player-only games we dig, Targi is a bit longer and has a bit more meat on it, with games taking over an hour.
Well, since being released in 2012, Targi has been nominated and won a number of awards, the two most notable being a 2012 Spiels des Jahres Kenner Spiel nomination and a 2013 Golden Geek nomination for Best Two-Player Board Game.
In Targi, you are the leader of a desert Tuareg tribe. You will collect and trade resources, earn gold, and use those to recruit other tribes to your cause. Mechanically, this is done by placing meeples on the edge of a 5x5 grid, activating those cards and claiming the cards where the rows and columns you claim intersect.
Targi comes in the standard size KOSMOS two-player game box, and it has a generic plastic box insert that works okay for sorting everything. We highly recommend using baggies if you aren't going to keep this game flat. The card quality is good, the workers are wood in clearly differentiated colors, and the resources are well-cut cardboard. Everything's just, it's nice quality. The rulebook is clear and easy to reference.
We don't have any complaints component-wise, but be aware that the entire thing can take up quite a bit of room. Sadly, that makes it so Targi doesn't work on smaller coffee shop or pub tables.
You start Targi by laying out the outside ring of the 5x5 grid of cards. They always go in the same order. You place the robber on the number one card. You then fill the center of the grid with goods and tribe cards, swapping between the two, so you end up with 5 goods and 4 tribes in play.
Each player collects the wooden pieces in their color, 2 of each resources, dates, salt, and pepper, 1 gold, and 4 points worth of victory tokens. The player that last ate a date gets to go first.
Each round of Targi has players placing their Targi figures onto one of the non-corner cards, edge cards. This can't be the card with the robber or where anyone else has placed. Once a figure is placed, that player has claimed that row or column, and no Targi may be placed on the card on the opposite side. The start player places, then their opponent, and back and forth until three Targi for both players are placed.
Next, you check the rows and columns you have your Targi on, and place a round tribe marker onto the two cards that intersect these rows and columns you control. Then the starting player activates each of their wooden pieces in any order they wish. This is followed by their opponent doing the same.
Each of the outsized cards has an action associated with it, which is explained on the cards. Some of these just let you take resources, others are more complicated. For example, the trader spot lets you trade three goods for one gold, or two gold, lets you trade three goods for one gold, or two goods for one of another good. The silversmith lets you change sets of goods into points, the caravan lets you flip over the top goods card and get whatever you draw, etc.
The middle cards are either goods cards, where you take the goods shown, discard the card, and replace it with one of the face-down tribe cards, or tribe cards you can purchase with your goods on hand. In addition, you can choose to hold on to one tribe card, which you can play later by taking the leader action. When you purchase or choose to hold a tribe card, it is immediately replaced by a face-down goods card.
Tribe cards come in five different types, and each is worth a set number of victory points at the end of the game, and most offer some kind of game-breaking ability or other end-game scoring opportunities. Tribe cards, when purchased, go into a 3x4 tableau in front of you, which you have to fill left to right, though you can choose which row to start on each time. At the end of the game, you'll get bonus points for full rows of four, with four different tribes or four rows of the same tribe, scoring extra points.
At the end of the round, face-down cards on the table are flipped. The start player moves to the next player, and the robber moves one spot around the outside edge. At each corner of the board, there's a raid card, and when the robber hits that spot, the players must pay the shown resources or they lose points. And after that, the robber moves to the next card.
The game ends at the end of the round when any player has filled their tableau with 12 tribe cards, or the robber makes it all the way around the board and back to the number one noble card. At that point, players add up their scores. The player with the most points wins. With the most gold, and then the most goods being the tiebreaker.
Now, I've got to thank the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch, for this one. They are the ones that convinced me to ask KOSMOS for a review copy of Targi when they approached us about some of their newer games, and it's been a huge hit with Deanna and I. Now, as you all know, we love solid, engaging two-player games that we can play together on date night, with a bonus for games that work at coffee shops, breweries, and pubs. And Targi is just about perfect for that. The only issue is that it takes up quite a bit of space and can be a bit hard to fit on two-seater tables.
I am so, so glad that we ended up checking out this game. A huge thanks to the folks that recommended it. Targi is the perfect two-player game to me, and it is almost the perfect coffee shop size. Just so flipping close.
Yeah, it's unfortunate when two-player games take up that little bit of extra space, because they're just a two-player game should fit on something about the size of a coffee table like that.
We were able to fit it on the table at one of our favorite breweries, but like the drinks had to go strategically and it was just fit.
Now, what I like most about Targi is the amount of decision points and depth in this game. It gives me that heavy Euro feel while playing in about an hour and working great with only two players.
I'm always super excited to find a two-player game that feels meaty and strategic, and that we can play in a relatively short time frame.
The grid-based worker placement system here really is brilliant, and it leads to some really tactical play. In this game, you have to watch what your opponent is doing and take that into consideration when placing your Targi. Denying your opponent's placement can be as important as getting what you want, and it's super rewarding when you can do both.
So there is a bit of trying to screw over your opponent, but I still swear this is a good date night game. You need to actually pay attention to what your opponent's up to. And yeah, picking the spot that you know they want is definitely part of the strategy.
A good date night game for gamers, I think, is really the kind of key here.
Yeah, because just the basic action spots, like your basic spots, the cards around the outside give you plenty of options and depth. But then there's the whole tribe card thing, right? Do you try to collect sets for bonus points? You're gonna buy one of each, so you have four different types. Sorry, there's five types, but buy four different cards so you can get that bonus. Or do you buy all the same number or same type of cards so you can get that bonus? Or do you ignore that and just buy based on abilities? Do you try to build an engine by getting tribe cards that play off each other? Now, as an example of this, there is a tribe card that makes it cheaper to play later tribe cards of the noble. Then every tribe has a card that makes buying cards of the same tribe cheaper. Well, I've seen Deanna use a strategy where she got the combo going where she never plays tribe cards when she buys them. She plays them all from the noble and then pays two less for everyone because of having those other combos. Of course, now when I see her doing this, I do everything I can to pick up those matching cards so I get them instead of her and I keep her away from the noble spot. And it's gameplay like that that keeps us coming back for more.
Yeah, this is not one of those one true way to win kinds of games, and I love that.
And if you have gotten bored of it, there is an expansion that adds a whole other level to the game and ups the difficulty even more.
Yeah, I need to check that out at some point. That'll be our next request to Cosmosis. Here, did you check out our Targi review? We loved it. Send us the other one. Now, one thing I will say is the box insert could be better. You can tell it's just like a generic box insert for game with cards and tokens. And it's always a bit of a mess when we open it up. Baggies definitely help. And I wouldn't be surprised if some people just toss that insert and just use bags.
Yeah, I don't have much bad to say about Targi. There's the usual complaint of I wish the text was bigger, but the iconography is super clear and easy to read. So I don't even mind having to pick up the tribe cards, but you do. And I think even going back before I had some vision problems, I would have had to pick these up and, you know, pass them around the table to be able to read them. I don't know what you could do to make the game better. And I do say that for the outside ones, I mean, we memorize them, right? And they expect you to, because they have the reverse side with just the icons on them instead of all the words. So it's a minor complaint.
We'll note that Folded Space does have a box insert for that keeps things together and allows you to, you know, take them out and put them onto the table in separate component pieces.
Yeah, you definitely need baggies for this one, or it's just a sad mess. I'd like to mention that there's a BGG upgrade token set for this, and it looks awesome. I almost bought it from Mo for our anniversary, but I hate shipping to Canada.
There is actually an official one as well for the 10th anniversary of the game. They put out an expansion that is wooden components for upgrades for things that also works with the expansion content.
See, that'd be a hard choice between, you know, those plastic geek up bits that we love for Quaxaquadenberg and other games, or wood. That's a hard choice. Overall, Targi has been the perfect fit for Deanna and I. I think that's going to be true for anyone who's into heavier Euro games. This is a small box two-player game that gives you the feel of a bigger box and a much longer game. Yeah, it takes up a bit more space than we'd like, but honestly, that cost pays off with the depth of gameplay. If you're a Euro fan and find yourself with just two of you looking for something to play on a game night, pick up Targi.
Get it. Just go get it. That's it.
Now, I got to say, if what you look for in a two-player game, or especially a date night game, is something light that doesn't require much attention, where you can kind of chat and enjoy a glass of wine while you're playing, Targi may not be the right choice. Now, while we do enjoy a pint or two of craft beer on our date nights, what we'll do is start off the night with Targi and then swap to lighter games as the night goes on.
Yeah, Targi requires attention. Honestly, this game is just not going to be fun unless you're paying close attention to it. So it is not a game to play when you are getting sloppy drunk.
Yeah, this is a mid-weight game. The base set comes in at about a 2-3 on Board Game Geek weight, up to over 2-5 with the expansion.
And our chat room has called us something I think is also important. If you don't like tag, take that, especially on your date night games. You may want to avoid Targi. There is an awful lot of messing over your opponent in this game. Again, the valid moves are often to deny your opponent from getting something. And quite a few of the cards are kind of nasty, especially the one that takes away your opponent's Targi for one round can be particularly devastating.
Can I say, though, that the difference here is it doesn't feel like I'm doing take that just for the, I don't know, shock value or the amusement of screwing someone else over, but more because it's the most tactical choice for you. And that's the difference there that makes it okay for a date night game for me.
Yeah, I agree. It's not nasty type of take that. It's not stab you in the back. It's just, it's competitive. There is definitely competition. If you're not into competition in your two-player games, there are cooperative options out there. I don't know. To me, Targi's good enough. I kind of feel like everyone should try it. Like, it's been around for a long time. There's probably someone near you who has a copy. If you do want to try the game out, if you're local, just ask. We'll bring it out to an event. I think this is just for hobby gamers who are into, like, probably the majority of our audience. I think you're going to dig Targi.
Yeah, I second that. I hate that it took us so long to getting around to trying this game. I will admit there's something about the box that just didn't draw me in. And I've seen it at stores and kind of dismissed it. So definitely, if you have also been overlooking this one, go try it out. It's pretty darn good.
Well, with that, it's time to pack up the caravan and move on to another game. I hope this gave you a good idea of what Targi is about and if it's a good fit for you and your group. We talk a lot about two-player games, but not often ones that are quite this old. What's a classic two-player game that you still play? Let us know.
Before we move on, just a reminder that we now have merch. That's right, you can declare your bellhop love through t-shirts and golf shirts and enjoy watching the live show with a cup of joe and your own tabletop bellhop mug. Just head over to tabletopbellhop.com/merch.
And you can save on shipping when you buy any two items and enter the code tabletop. After all, if you're going to sit down to play Targi, you better both have a bellhop mug.
Regular listeners know I'm a huge Supers fan, and one of the best Supers board games I've played is KAPOW. Stay tuned to find out why.
KAPOW was originally published by Two Ton Porcupine, but was later picked up by Wize Wizard Games, who did some tweaks and re-released the game as a two-box set, KAPOW Volume 1 and KAPOW Volume 2. Before we get into more details, I do want to thank Debbie at Wize Wizard for hooking us up with a review copy of both volumes. Specific thanks for insisting we take both volumes.
The original KAPOW was designed by Larry Baguki, Douglas Hetrick, and Carl Van Ostrand. This new version had some further design and development from Wize Wizard's Robert Doherty.
The first thing you need to know is that both volumes of KAPOW, and that's with an exclamation mark, are nearly identical. They have matching component counts. The only difference is that each features a different set of six characters, three heroes and three villains. The second thing you need to know is that to play with four players, you need both sets. Oh, and based on our plays, you're going to want to play with four. The game really shines at four.
A single game of KAPOW can last 30 minutes to over an hour, depending on luck, AP, player skill, and player count. Solo games, on the other hand, only take about 15 minutes.
There are a lot of icons in the game, and each character is very asymmetric, but the mechanics are rather simple. Learning to play is quick and easy. Learning to play well, though, that's something else.
Now, while the box notes this is for ages 12 plus, we think that's more based on small components than complexity. We can totally see younger kids enjoying this one a lot.
KAPOW recreates a superheroic battle between unlicensed heroes and villains who are trying to knock out their opponents. This is done through dice-driven engine building that includes customizable dice. Roll your dice each turn and spend them to attack, defend, and upgrade your character. Play player versus player or combine sets to do a comic book style team up. You can even go Dark Knight and play solo versus any of the characters through a cool bot system.
Check out the components in this comic-based battler in our KAPOW unboxing video on YouTube.
There you can see the customizable dice and a pile of different sides you can swap in and out, the non-customizable dice, each of the characters in both sets, the solid playing boards with their clear iconography, the box inserts, various tokens, and more.
Overall, the component quality here is really good. There are a couple things that could be improved, like the size of the player screens versus the size of the boards you have to put behind them, and the fact that I have a couple dice where one side doesn't quite want to stick, but overall, I was impressed.
I have no complaints. I haven't personally had any problems with the dice sticking, though I know you have. I think it's easy to assemble them and take them apart, and everything is lasting really well. It's just, it's a well-made game.
Yeah, I think the size of the player backing boards is weird because it doesn't fit. And we did have one particular die where the side would occasionally not stick in. And that was that was frustrating because you never really know if you rolled it properly, if you rolled it blank, or if it fell off from it being on the side. But that being said, it's not the end of the world, and it's easy to solve. A little bit of blue tack and do the job nicely.
So the standard way to play KAPOW is a 1v1 two-player game. While the components are set up to play hero versus villain, you're welcome to mix and match. Heroes can train against each other, and while villains are often at odds with each other. The rules include an introductory game where you don't choose characters. Now, we're going to skip over that and move right to the full game.
Each player chooses one of the characters to play and gathers the dice for that character. This is going to be a mix of non-customizable trait die in different colors and or customizable action dice with a set starting face. All of this is indicated on each character's board, as is your starting health.
Both players place a screen in front of their player and character boards and roll their dice. Then they place these dice onto their boards to activate abilities. There are four types of abilities: attack, defense, power-up, and after power-up.
Now, attack and defense abilities have two sections: basic moves and kickers. To be able to use the kickers, you have to activate a basic ability first. You can't just use a kicker. Now, kickers modify the basic moves and can have any number of kickers on a single basic move. The important part to remember is you got to do the basic attack before you can make it better.
Yeah, I kept trying to skip that. That's bad. The power-up abilities let you improve your character, gaining new dice or die faces for your customizable dice, or letting you swap things around. After power-up abilities are used, when you think your opponent is powering up and do damage for upgrades, your opponent takes that turn.
Well, that's your thing. You have power-up abilities and after power-up abilities. The after power-up abilities are used when you think your opponent's powering up. When you think
your opponent is powering up and do damage for upgrades, your opponent takes that turn. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
There are also a couple of spots that let you re-roll dice and a spot that lets you heal. Plus, every character has their own set of unique abilities that fall somewhere in with the standard four types.
Now, once players have placed their dice, the screens are removed and you resolve all of these actions. The active player attacks first, totaling their damage, then the defending player totals their defense and takes damage equal to the difference if above zero. If this damage is enough to knock your opponent out, you win. They also collect any defensive upgrades, because many of the defensive abilities give you faces for your customizable dice, as well as preventing damage.
Next, the defender attacks back using the same system. Attack minus defense equals damage, and then they grab any upgrades. Then in turn order, players complete the power-up and after power-up actions.
At the end of each round, there's a cleanup phase. Here, players clear all of their dice on their boards and get to attach and rearrange the faces on their customizable dice. The game continues until one player KOs their opponent and wins. The player with the least health goes first the next round, with ties going to the villain.
When playing with four players, you split into two teams, usually two heroes versus two villains, but again, you're free to mix that up. Players on the same team are free to talk, collaborate, and discuss where to place their dice, but can't actually trade anything or share their dice. Now, when spending your dice, you also need to decide who you're attacking and use a special arrow token to point at whoever you want to hit.
In addition, each team gets a set of team-up cards. These are placed between the players on the same size and are activated by each player contributing the appropriate dice to the cards.
If a player is attacked twice in the same round, their defense number counts for both attacks, but they only collect any upgrades once.
Teammates share a health pool equal to the total of each individual's character's health and the last team standing wins.
Now, you can also play KAPOW solo or cooperatively. Every single character can also act as an AI opponent. The back of the character's boards show the actions they will take each round. After rolling your dice and placing yours, you then roll the AI's dice and work your way down their player board to activate their abilities.
For co-op, you play two humans versus two AI, and all attacks are done against the target with the most defense. All the other rules stay the same.
Note, there is no official way to play KAPOW with three players.
So that was a super high-level overview that doesn't really give you an idea of the tactical depth of KAPOW. This is really hard to get across just talking about it, but it's really easy to highlight with the boards and dice in front of you. One important concept that I think is really important about this game and that I didn't get until sitting down to play it is that there's really never a terrible roll. There is always something valid to do, and even blank dice rolls are useful.
Almost every roll, you have more than one choice with how you're going to lay out. And yeah, it's pretty darn strategic. And yes, even blank dice are useful.
Yeah, unlike Dice Throne, for instance, which we've reviewed in the past, this isn't a Yahtzee game. Your dice are going to be spread out and placed, and there's any number of ways to arrange and rearrange. And when you're playing with another player, with a teammate, you might rearrange multiple times as you try and figure out different strategies and lay out plans on how to attack your opponents.
And then something else I don't think that really comes up when you're trying to describe the game, right, or even when teaching the game, is the escalation that happens. This is an engine building game. And just like an epic comic book battle, things keep getting bigger as the fight goes on. Like at the start of the game, you're going to be sticking with basic attacks and defense, maybe a small kicker, and spending quite a few of your dice on improving your character. But then the last round, you might be pulling off an attack with three kickers and a multiplier, resulting in reducing the opponent's damage and doing half their health in one hit.
Yeah, I really like the way it ramps up, and it feels thematically superhero battle-ish, and there's also just something really satisfying about it.
Yeah, the asymmetry in the characters is really interesting as well, because some of them have, you know, smaller things that they can peck away at people with, while others may not seem to be doing much, but they're actually building up for that big whopper after three rounds have gone by and they've achieved something that they needed.
And my favorite part of KAPOW is the puzzle of figuring out the best use of your dice each turn. There are so many options that you never have a totally bad roll. And figuring out a cool way to use all those blanks in particular always feels very rewarding to me.
I have a little problem with AP with this game, and I felt much less guilty playing the solo version because I could just take my time to try and figure out the optimal way to lay out the dice without going, oh, I don't want to hold things up.
Yeah, it's interesting. I've noticed myself having a bit of AP on it because you know that there's almost... You feel like you're certain there's going to be a better way than what you chose the first way. You saw something and you went that way and you're like, well, but wait, if I do this, and then all of a sudden you're rearranging every single one of the dice you rolled and you're going down a rabbit hole. It's really easy to fall down rabbit holes of how to place the dice.
Now, another aspect of KAPOW I like is, I guess, the bluffing element, the kind of poker thing, a little bit of social deduction of trying to figure out what your opponent's going to do. That is a big part of the game. Like if you think your opponent's about to spend all this time, all their dice on upgrading, then you make sure to use those after upgrade, after power-up. Sorry, power-up's the proper term. You think they're going to upgrade, you use those after power-up abilities. Or if you expect them to throw a bunch of dice into defense, maybe you don't attack this turn and instead upgrade yourself that turn. Or it's getting near the end of the game. Do you just go for a huge attack and forgo defense? Whatsoever, or are you better doing a balance? Like, I'll do about 10 damage, but I want to defend about 10. And that's all fun and interesting decisions.
Yeah, those turns where you decide not to attack and then you find out your opponent didn't defend. Oh, that is the worst.
Or when you're playing too. Or when you're playing teams and you both decide to team up and you team up on the person who's doing the defending and not the one who's left themselves open. And even just, you know, making sure you're keeping track of what the other opponent's health is at, because you may have a really big move that will leave you super vulnerable. But if you're the weaker player and you're getting to go first, you may be able to knock them out and take the win before it matters.
Yep. Now, another part of KAPOW I, of course, love, which Sean already called up, is that asymmetry, right? Because each of the 12 characters that currently exist in the game play differently. And it's impressive how varied each feel. And honestly, this applies to both sides of the screen. Like, it feels different playing each character yourself and deciding on where to use your dice and figuring out that, oh, this is a character I need to build up to do something, but also how different it feels depending on who you're facing. Which opponent you're playing against is going to change your tactics as much as which hero you're playing yourself.
And that hero you're playing is going to feel different against different characters. Like yes. The level of variability there is just massive.
Yeah, it's interesting. And surprisingly, while there are a couple of sort of serial numbers filed off, oh, we know who that is, not all of them are. They are unique creations, and I mean, some of it is just a matter of there are certain archetypes in superheroes where you're going to get, you know, the tank or what mm-hmm. have you. But they really have done a nice job of creating 12 unique and interesting characters.
Now, while I enjoyed all my 2-player games of KAPOW, like it's a solid dueling game. The game really showed its strength, though, as a team game. Creating a comic crossover battle was a ton of fun. Now, one of the big advantages here is the fact this is a puzzle game, right? Having another brain to work with is nice. There are a lot of ways to use your dice. And just like any puzzle game, having a teammate to point out things you missed can be very useful.
Yeah, I love the way the two boxes interact. I mean, even just having 12 overall characters to play, let alone the team play, is a reason to pick up the second box. But the team play is so solid.
Yeah, absolutely. The first time I played it was just one-on-one, and it was a fun game. But I don't think it shined as well as it could have. But then when we sat down and played that team player game, it was all in. And it was just a totally different experience that was night and day above what was already a good experience. It became, I think, a really kind of a great experience.
Now, I was also impressed by KAPOW as a solo experience. I think it works very well as a solid single-player game because of that puzzle aspect. The entire AI system works well. It's not too fiddly. And I like the way you have to spend all your dice before rolling for your opponent. So you don't know things like, are they going to defend? Are they going to attack? Or are they going to level up? Now, I will say the AI seemed to be gaining faces and dice way quicker than I could. But maybe it was just who I fought against. I do love the fact that basically every single character, all 12, has their own solo mode. Like that is a ridiculous number of possible combinations to play as a solo experience.
What I loved about the solo is that the AI just made sense. I never had to go look something up. I think this is the first solo game I've ever played where I wasn't consulting the rule book. Everything laid out made sense, and it just played like, well, if you already know the game. It all just made sense based on the iconography and the way you play the game. And I will say that possibly the dice coming quicker than you could keep up was just the randomness of the game, because that didn't happen in my play. But yeah, I really liked the solo play. And as I said earlier, I liked the fact that I could sit and stare at it for a while and think out the optimal move.
Yeah, it's kind of nice in a time where so many solo games are trying to give that deep, complex experience and putting in the Automa's decks of cards and alternate versions of this and that and the other thing. This just kind of plays straightforward and the way you expect it to, like another game, but without another person in front of you, just a card that's telling you what to do.
Our biggest concern with KAPOW are the customizable action dice. Sean called out one die, but I know I have at least two. Right from the start, I found at least two of my dice had at least one side on them that doesn't hold the faces as well as the others. Now, currently, when that one of those comes up, I just swap it for one of the other dice, right? Or if I do end up, I have to draft that dice. I'll just whatever problematic side where it falls off, I'll fill last. My big worry, though, is I'm just kind of concerned this will get worse over time. Like, so far, it hasn't happened. Those loose dice started that way and have stayed that way, but I do worry with where this could become a bigger problem. Now, to Wize Wizard Games' defense, they specifically pointed out they have demo copies of this that have been played far more times than your average gamer would play a copy of the game, and their demo copies are still fine. So I just think I got some bad luck on a couple dice.
Yeah, it might just be like a quality control issue. I will say I find snapping the pieces in note really easy. They don't stick. So, I mean, falling out being loose being a separate issue. Like I said, I did not experience my games because I just happened to not get the loose die. But they're easy to take in note.
Yeah, they do provide you with a little tool to pop them out if you don't have nails. But if you do have nails, I've never had a problem getting them in or out. The problem really does come, though, when that one piece drops out as you roll. Because that kind of breaks that turn, which can be really unfortunate. You know, do you just roll again, like reassemble it and roll again, or what? Because you never necessarily know where that piece has fallen off from. And have to deal with that.
The anytime it's happened to me, it's always been obvious. I'm like, well, that side's not up because another side's up. So it must have been one of these blank sides. So I just reattach it and keep going. But I'm sure it could come up, especially if you have lots of action dice. Overall, I really liked KAPOW since my first play. First play was with Gwen at one of our barbershop bar game nights. I found every game was close. We never knew who was going to win until the very end. I love how different each character plays and feels, and they seem well balanced. I would have been happy with this game as a two-player only dueling game, but I was shocked to discover I really like it at four players, and even playing solo. KAPOW is a big hit for me, and I'm so glad Debbie convinced us to take both volumes to try it out at four players.
Well, if you like...
Yeah, I super enjoyed this game, and I am looking forward to trying to find time to play it solo again.
Well, if you like superhero games, KAPOW is really solid. It feels tight and thematic. While it may not feature licensed characters, the characters that they have created fit most of the standard tropes and are pretty cool. The escalation here is what really makes this game feel like an epic comic book battle.
If you dig dice games and love trying to figure out the best way to use a bad roll, you're probably going to love KAPOW. Same goes for puzzle game fans who like trying to find the ultimate combo or to squeeze one more point of defense or attack out of your limited resources. On the other side, though, if you don't like conflict in your games, you're probably best staying away from KAPOW, though you may be interested in the solo or cooperative gameplay modes.
The same thing goes for players who hate the randomness of dice. This game involves a lot of dice rolling. That said, as we mentioned before, there's never a point in KAPOW where you can't do something with your dice, and even rolls that seem bad can turn out quite good. But if you don't like not being able to use exactly the move that you want to use when you want to, this one's probably not for you.
Now, before we go, I want to spend a moment comparing KAPOW to another dice-driven superhero battle game we reviewed recently and that Sean mentioned earlier, and that is Marvel Dice Throne from the Op. I think it's very hard, if you played both these games, not to compare them. And I encourage anyone who hasn't played Dice Throne to check out our review. Now, personally, I enjoy both games. I love how each does its own thing, and it's kind of fascinating because these are both dice-driven super battle battlers that feel very different. Both really nail the game balance, and both feature asymmetry, which you all know is something I love. Now, what I think Marvel does a little better is theme, but that's just because it features Marvel characters, and the gameplay mechanics for each character makes you feel like you're playing that character. Like, just try playing Loki in that game, and you're going to get it. Other than that, though, I personally prefer KAPOW. In addition to the asymmetry, I love the engine building. I love engine building games. And while there are the upgrade cards in Marvel, you don't really get that feeling of escalation that you do with KAPOW. Plus, I love the puzzle aspect of KAPOW. Getting that seemingly bad roll and making it work just feels great.
I think where Dice Throne wins is it has the Marvel IP, so it's easier to sell people on. You show them, hey, you get to play Loki, and it's easier to get them to the table. And I do think that maybe the comic book feeling, it gets that one better for me, the feeling of comic book characters. But when it comes down to the gameplay and the engine building aspects, I also think I prefer KAPOW.
Yeah, this one's tough for me because I really do enjoy both of them. But they do sort of scratch different itches, I guess, is one way to look at it. I mean, for one thing, with the Marvel Dice Throne, you also have the ability of going down the adventure path if you do want to do solo play and things like that. Whereas otherwise, you don't get the solo. You don't have the co-op. You do have team, but and melee. You can do three players of Dice Throne, which you can't in KAPOW. But again, that engine builder is a really nice feel in KAPOW. Mm-hmm. Like, that is really the selling point. That is what you're going for, is that escalation throughout the battle until finally someone does something that knocks out all of the remaining hit points you've been trying to eke out.
Marvel Dice Throne and KAPOW are two superhero games. There are tons out there. While it's not as common as, say, zombies or farming, there are a number of different choices out there. And what I want to know is, what's your favorite? I want to know if we played it yet.
Leave us a comment wherever you found this review and let us know about your favorite comic book inspired board games.
Our kryptonite is caffeine. If you enjoyed this review, and it helped you learn a bit more about KAPOW, or better yet, convinced you to pick it up, how about you treat us to a coffee at ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end. It's been doors and go mourn our review process.
So you might want to do that again because you froze again. Aww. As you were saying about how bad a night it's been, you froze.
Sorry, explicit ding, ding, ding. My bad. That means our shift's coming to an end. It's been a long shift. It's time to go home. We're locking the lobby doors and commiserating our attempt at reviewing games smoothly tonight.
But before we get to start locking things down, we need to take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
First up, Diane Tuzano. Thank you, Mom.
Brian Sheen. Thank you, Brian.
Dukas, thank you.
Roger Milosh, who failed to be here for his question to be answered. Thanks anyway.
Thank you to David Miller Jr.
Ron F. Thank you, Ron. Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but we're all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
So we've been changing up a lot of things around here. Like, I've now started sharing first thought reviews on our Patreon. Deanna's now a regular on the show. We're doing a lot more on Instagram, and we're messing with the webpage. What we really appreciate hearing is what you think about these changes. Send your feedback to mo@tabletopbellhop.com, comment on any of our social media posts, or send us a direct message. What do you like? Is there anything you think we should have kept the same? Do you like the direction we're heading? We want to know.
I want to know if you guys want to see what we were talking about earlier with the potential different show segments when we were talking about the 13th floor. So shout in on that, too. And that's all for tonight. The other thing we would love is you giving us a thumbs up, a like, or better yet, telling your friends and fellow gamers about our show.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.